If you were to list your favorite animated films released in the last 30 years, there's a good chance Kelly Asbury had a hand in many of them. Whether he was a director, a storyboard artist, or a designer, he contributed something special to all of them, and it always made me happy seeing his name in the end credits. His first job in the animation industry was at Deke Entertainment, where he drew storyboards for the television series The Littles. He then moved over to Disney, where he started as an in-betweener on The Black Cauldron, and a layout artist on the television special Sport Goofy in Soccer Mania. He was promoted to visual development artist on The Little Mermaid, where he played a key role in designing the look of the film, including the Royal Palace, the Under the Sea musical number, and Ariel's Secret Grotto. Kelly Asbury was given even more responsibilities on The Rescuers Down Under, serving as a storyboard artist and character designer in addition to visual development. He was also the art director for Roller Coaster Rabbit, designing the colorful and violent carnival Roger Visits. Proving his versatility, he moved on to the story department on Beauty and the Beast. Asbury was responsible for one of the movie's most iconic images, when he suggested the Enchanted Rose float inside a glass case. In his role as assistant art director on The Nightmare Before Christmas, he was pivotal in designing the spooky world of Halloween Town. He also helped Pixar with their first feature film, Toy Story, providing storyboards, and then reunited with Nightmare director Henry Selick on James and the Giant Peach, where he was a storyboard supervisor. Kelly Asbury eventually got an invitation to join the then recently founded DreamWorks, spending a decade there. One of his first assignments was as artistic supervisor in the story department for The Prince of Egypt. He also got the chance to collaborate with Aardman, providing storyboards for Chicken Run. It's a credit to Asbury's skills that not long after joining DreamWorks, he was asked to direct an adaptation of William Steig's book, Shrek, which at that point was going to star Chris Farley as an ogre who falls in love with a fairy tale princess. He worked on the story for a while, but then left to co-direct Spirit, Stallion of the Cimarron with Lorna Cook. Spirit provided quite a few challenges for the production team, mainly because horses are notoriously difficult to animate. Horses also don't have the most expressive faces, and the decision was made to not have Spirit and the other animals talk, instead relying on narration by Matt Damon. Considering the hurdles Asbury and Cook faced, the animation does well in conveying what the horses are thinking and feeling in given moments. The movie succeeded in showing the old American frontier, and the sequences where Spirit is galloping through the fields and deserts are impressive. Care was also taken to make sure the Lakota Americans were treated with respect when Spirit finds himself befriending one and spending time with a tribe. Spirit, Stallion of the Cimarron was an ambitious project for DreamWorks, and even with its flaws, one can still see the artistry Kelly Asbury, Lorna Cook, and their team brought to the film. Asbury finally got the chance to direct a Shrek movie when he was brought on board the second film. Co-directing with Andrew Adamson and Conrad Vernon, Shrek 2 had the added pressure, living up to the enormously popular first movie. The sequel doubled on the pop culture humor of its predecessor, but still retained the heart as we see the continued relationship between Shrek and Fiona, as they deal with the in-laws. The fairy godmother is a memorable and diabolical villain, and Shrek 2 is fun with its take on familiar fairy tales. The addition of Puss in Boots was a particularly inspired choice, as his Zorro-inspired antics and Antonio Banderas' voice work instantly made him an audience favorite. Watching Shrek 2 again recently, something that struck me is how well it used music. There are a number of musical montages throughout the movie, which could have easily gotten tiring. And yet Asbury, Adamson, and Vernon directed all of them with the needed energy. All of the songs contribute something to the story and the sequences. Shrek 2 already begins on a high note with an original song, Accidentally in Love, played over a hilarious montage of Shrek and Fiona on their honeymoon. There's also the clever use of Funky Town when they arrive at Far Far Away, David Bowie's Changes when a magical potion transforms our three leads, Puss and Donkey ending the movie with a duet of Living La Vida Loca, and most famously of all, the fairy godmother performing a cover of Holding Out for a Hero. The way the sequence builds with the music and we cut between the various characters is so brilliantly done. Shrek 2 was a worthy follow-up to the first film, with an understanding of where to take its lovable ogres next, and Kelly Asbury definitely deserves a lot of credit for how well he pulled off this chapter in their story. He continued working on DreamWorks for a while, helping out on Shrek the Third and storyboarding on Kung Fu Panda and Madagascar 2. He was then hired by Elton John to bring his passion project, a comedic version of Romeo and Juliet with gnomes, to life. With Romeo and Juliet, Asbury put his own spin on the story, turning it into a colorful and family-friendly jukebox musical. Much like Shrek 2, he showed an ability in mixing music with montages. Utilizing classic Elton John songs and a few new tunes written specifically for the movie, Asbury clearly had fun with pairing the likes of Crocodile Rock and Don't Go Breaking My Heart to these ceramic characters. The movie has some clever little details throughout, including nods to Shakespeare's other work and the way the gnomes make clinking sounds when they move. After Romeo and Juliet proved a surprise box office hit for Touchstone Pictures, Kelly Asbury returned to Walt Disney Animation to contribute storyboards for Wreck-It Ralph and Frozen. Sony Pictures Animation then asked him to direct a new adaptation of Peo's classic Blue Creatures. A longtime fan, he jumped at the chance to create a faithful take on those iconic characters with Smurf's The Lost Village. He really tried to remain true to Peo's original drawings, faithfully translating the Smurfs and Gargamel to computer animation. The movie showed an enormous amount of visual imagination, a notable emphasis on Smurfette and her own insecurities about her place in Smurf Village. Asbury was so excited to work on this project, he even started a blog leading up to the film's release that talked about his experiences directing the movie. His passion and admiration for the Smurfs definitely comes through in every frame of the film. It was not long after the release of The Lost Village he was asked to direct Ugly Dolls, an animated film based on the toy line. Originally directed by Robert Rodriguez, the film's distributor, STX, only gave Asbury a year to complete the movie in time for summer 2019 release date. If you know anything about animation, a year is a very short time frame to complete an animated feature. Kelly Asbury later said he wished he was given more time to work on Ugly Dolls, but he pressed through and managed to finish it by the studio's desired date. A common theme you may notice in the films he has directed is they are often about different communities, who then realize they can work together and that they're better united than as enemies. That message was also reflected in Ugly Dolls, as it highlighted the conflict between the unique toys who reside in Uglyville and the more conventional dolls living in perfection. While the film has its occasional story problems due to the truncated production schedule, Asbury still brought a bounce to his direction during the musical numbers. The standout sequence in Ugly Dolls ends up being the song Unbreakable. That song, beautifully performed by Kelly Clarkson and Janelle Monáe, had a lovely message for anyone of any age. The lyrics of Unbreakable on the importance of not letting the harsh words of others affect you were ones I really needed to hear at the time. The movie truly comes alive in that moment, and Asbury's direction is a major reason why. It was also fitting in the case of Ugly Dolls, as before the movie was released, and even shortly afterwards, the online animation community mocked the film and the people who made it. It was disgusting and disappointing to see so-called animation fans say cruel words about an artist who had played a key role in some of the most beloved animated films of the last three decades. I hope he never got to hear those words of discouragement. Regardless, Kelly Asbury was a filmmaker whose credentials made him respected and sought after by studios all over the world. One really exciting project he was going to direct at one point was an animated film based on Marisa de Souza's comic strip dinosaur Horatio. It's a shame that never came to fruition, as it would have brought more worldwide attention to de Souza's creations, and de Souza himself was very enthusiastic about Asbury's participation. Sadly, Kelly Asbury passed away on June 26 of this year at the age of 60. It was shocking news, as he was not only highly creative, but by all accounts, he was one of the nicest people working in animation. He's definitely an artist and filmmaker whose work has left an incredible legacy, whether he was drawing storyboards or in charge of an entire production. Thank you, Mr. Asbury, for helping an ogre find true love, helping a Smurf find a purpose, giving a mermaid her own hiding place, and your many other extraordinary accomplishments.